So, you know, everybody, once again, welcome you to the School of the Spirit. And I think the most important things for God's people to recognize is that the Holy Ghost has come here to lead us and guide us. And He's with us and He's in us. And I think that if there's any challenge, it's to get people to believe that. It's addressed early on in your walk with the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you come to call upon the name of the Lord and you begin to be taught the things of this, of the Word of God by the church, it's one of the first things that is supposed to be addressed in your life, but somehow folks don't really get it. And God, in His loving kindness and tender mercies and long suffering, stays right with us. Say, nope, this is really true. I'm here to lead you. I'm here to guide you. I'm with you and I'm in you. No, really, I am. I'm here to lead you. I'm here to guide you. I'm with you and I'm in you. No, I'm still here. I'm right here. I am here. I'm here. I'm the one with all the power and all the authority. As you're screaming out there somewhere about wanting to move in the flow and operate in the gifts of the Spirit, hello, I'm with you and I'm in you. And I want to teach you, and I want to lead you, and I guide you. I'm here. I'm not a little voice. I am a wellspring springing. I am a river gushing. Hello, could you please recognize me? I'm really here. You know, 40 years later. Yep, I am. I'm really here. I'm here to lead you and to guide you. I love you. I think that if there's anything that we are challenged with, for some unknown reason, is we are challenged with believing the love that God has for us. And of course, we know that it isn't entirely an unknown reason. But to just really rest in this place of knowing and believing the love that God has for us, resting in the revelation of 1 John chapter 4, knowing that anyone who is in this love and dwells in this love and choose to cooperate with this love and choose to believe this love, choose to allow this love not only to be poured into them as they recognize this love, but allow this love to be poured out of them, poured in by the Holy Ghost, poured out by the Holy Ghost, that our love has been made perfect. I mean, we fully mature. Keep in mind that you just don't fully mature in love because you are willing to give all diligence and attendance to it. You also mature in faith and in purity and in knowledge. The knowledge of God is an amazing thing. With the knowledge of God, you have the insights to deal. You have the insight to deal with every problem in an accurate way. Oh, my, just to move into the knowledge of God, to give yourself to the knowledge of God. I could spend the night talking about the knowledge of God. And the Bible is devoted to the revelation of the knowledge of God so that you and I can function in His understanding. Wow. I pray in the name of Jesus that if there's anything we begin to learn about the Holy Ghost and that what the teacher wants to develop us in are the things that we were given when we were born of the Spirit and given the divine nature and made a new creature and made a new creation that only the Word of God describes to us. Listen, some people think that God has spoken His Word and His commandments and it's just random ideas to see if you're paying attention and will cooperate with Him. It isn't. It is instruction in the way of life to say, do this and you get to live. It's Him telling us this is how the Spirit works. This is how the realms of heaven work. This is how truth works. And if we really believe that, then we would have all memorized the Bible, or at least a big part of it. And if we didn't memorize it, we would know it so well. See, I don't think you have to memorize something that you do every day. I don't think you have to memorize it. I remember my vows that I said to my wife 32 years ago. Why? Because I gave myself to doing them. I mean, I didn't always do them perfect. I'm more perfect at doing them now than I was then, but I gave myself to doing them. Listen, God's Word is something even so much more powerful. It is aided and we are helped by the Holy Ghost to do it. Do them, and His Word is, by the way, it in itself is living. In itself, it's spirit. It's living. And God gave to us in this wonderful anointing, in this wonderful new birth, in this life. He gave to us understanding. He gave to us knowledge. He gave to us counsel. He gave to us might. I mean, oh my goodness. He gave to us the fear of the Lord. He gave to us all of the dimensions of his own spirit, of who he is. But you have to give yourself to these things to have them. Too many people are willing to be taught by men and give themselves over to those things that are necessary so you can have a paycheck at the end of the week and then have everybody tell you what a responsible, good citizen you are or whatever it is that you get out of that. What is it that we get out of this? Huh? A car, a dog, a house, a cupboard, a food? A bed to sleep in. I mean, what is that it? Is that life? Is that what life consists of? By no means. Father wants us to give ourselves to understanding something far beyond all of that. And if we're willing to do so, then the Holy Spirit, he's come to our aid. He's come to lead us. He's come to guide us. He's come to instruct us in this way. And then ultimately, if I say, listen, I'm going to go over here and I'm just going to dwell in God. I'm just going to dwell in his love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. I'm going to learn how to do that. I mean, I tell you right now, you got yourself a fit on your hands. A fit of circumstance, a fit of situation, a fit of problems around you by those who maybe are even as close to you in human relationship, all the way out there to your boss and to all the people that don't like you, is running some kind of interference against you and I dwelling this love. So there has to be a transcendence. There has to be a moving out of that which is imposed upon us by what we see on a purely sensual level, and I'm moving into something that is an interaction on a spiritual level, and that's why the Word of God and praise. If I can get people to worship, if I can just get people to worship, it is like pulling teeth out of a chicken. They don't have any, and it's just a difficult issue. But it is difficult to get people to worship, to try to instruct people to worship. Because you stop in the middle of worship and say, what on earth do you guys do? And then everybody just... They all feel like they feel just overwhelmed and disappointed and daddy doesn't like me. No. Hello. Forget about that. You a soldier. You now a candidate to be trained to walk as a king and as a priest and as someone anointed of God. Can we get past the baby stuff long enough to move into the adult stuff? Can we get past all of the childish stuff long enough to move into the God stuff? Are you listening to me? The human stuff to move into the God stuff. The earthy to move into the divine. Because there has to be instruction. And if you can't do it in church, you're not doing it anywhere. Oh, I know you think you're doing it, but it ain't what God wants. That's why you don't have what God wants. That's why we're still looking a way off. And that's why Father's having such a hard time. We're still waiting for a day to come. And Father's having such a hard time convincing us that he's in us. And he's with us. And he's come to lead us and to guide us and to instruct us. And he's there to teach us. And he's brought all that belongs to heaven right down into our life. That it's not something that we got to attain to. It's something that was gifted with us. It's in us. But we've got to be willing to dwell in it. We've got to be willing to give ourselves to it. We've got to give all attendance and diligence to these things, saying, I'm going to have this. I'm going to have faith. I'm going to have virtue. I'm going to have this knowledge. I'm going to have this self-control. I'm going to have this patience. I'm going to have this godliness. I'm going to have this brotherly kindness. I'm going to have this divine love. And the list goes on. And it's not like a list. Oh, well, check that off. I got that one. Praise God. It is living a life. It's like enjoying being alive. It's a tough thing to teach people. How to enjoying being alive. How to worship. If you can wake up in the morning and you can hear the Word of God, you can go to run to the Word of God and say, this is my bread, this is my life. And you give yourself to the Word and you give yourself to worship. My, your whole life would be changed in no time. And boy, you'd be a benefit to the church. Amen. Wow, because that'd be real. Well, you know, we may, you know, I'm never going to restrain anybody or to say anybody needs to settle down, but, you know, just kind of, you know, wishfully, we may have to actually tell you to calm down a bit. It's just too lavish. It's just too excited. It's just too... It just fills your emotions. It just fills your spirit. You're having this expression that you actually love God with all your heart, with all your spirit, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is where the Holy Spirit's come to teach us how to live here. This is these are fundamental things. Father helps us. We're really at the very core of what it is he wants to do. And then, you know, I love the proofs that are laid out in the first epistle of John. And, you know, when you're looking there in 1 John chapter 4, and the Lord says, anyone who's afraid, anyone who has fear, you're not made perfect in love. Love casts out all fear. Fear has torment. You were given the spirit of sonship. Romans 8:15, you were given the spirit of sonship. Hallelujah. You're given the spirit of sonship. You say, God is my dad. There is no more fear there. You were delivered from the bondage of fear. You were liberated. Because fear, listen, love cannot exist with fear any more than doubt and unbelief can exist with faith. And they are parallels to one another. And it's just a whole issue, people. It's a whole issue. You can blame whatever. You can blame God, the Holy Ghost, yourself, the preacher, the pastor, the singing, the worship. I don't know. Go on and on. The reality of it is people are just settling down into believing that God loves you and that, you know, he don't have to prove it every day. Huh? Somebody said, well, I want that. Well, then what you got to do is you've got to learn how to participate with the one who's in you and with you and has come to lead you and to guide you. You have to participate with him. How do you do that? With his word. He's truth. He's truth. You're not going to find him in your illusion. You're not going to find him in your lie. You're not going to find him in all your efforts and all of your deeds and all the things that are rushing through your mind, all the things you believe that you've got to do and you believe is true. You're not going to find him there. You're going to find him in the word. You're going to find him with the word of God coming out of your mouth. And you say, Lord, I thank you that you are in me like a wellspring springing up. I thank you that you are in me like a river flowing out. I thank you that you are here right now. You're not somewhere far, far away. I'm not reaching out and trying to grasp for straws. Oh, God, why can't I feel your presence like Pastor Mark says? That is just, I would hate to be that. I would hate to live in such a lie, in such a captivity, a blindness of heart and mind, a literal expression of, oh, how I love me. True. That's the realm of selfishness. That's the realm of man. That's it, me. It's all about me. That's it. God came to deliver us from all about me and oh, how I love me. To be able to say, oh, how I love him. He gave me his life. I now live in him. I no longer live. And people look all cross-eyed because they're territorial. They're clinging to their self-interest. They're holding on to the stuff that they want. They're jealous because they don't want anybody else to get their credit or their stuff. Father wants you to learn how to worship and let it all go and give. He wants you to get inspired by his word. His word will inspire you. Hallelujah. It will inspire you to a lie, to an illusion, to something that is meaningless, it has no profit, to some wild imaginations that aren't even true, has no connection with reality, but you believe it. Should I say all of that again? Because you need to hear it. You thought it was true. You thought it was real. There's no connection to reality at all. The Word of God's true. The Holy Ghost is true. Our biggest problem with connecting with the Holy Ghost is this is the whole issue. Truth. Truth. What is truth and what is real? What is really the value of my life? What is really the meaning of my life? What is it the Father wants me to do? What does it really all matter? Why am I even here? Why did Father do it the way he's done it? Why did Father create man with an earthly body to bring him one at some point to the tree of life? What's all going on in the discipline of what Father has purposed to produce within our life? What is it? What is the meaning of redemption? What is the meaning of this fellowship? What is the meaning of this union? What is it that Father wants me to agree to? What is it that he wants me to express? What is it that he wants me to confess? What is it that he wants me to believe? What is it that he wants me to receive from him? You're gonna find this. Just open up your Bible, read the word. You're gonna find this by worshiping him and praising him. What you're going to discover in this is you're going to find that the Holy Ghost is there. Because that's what he came for. Truth and worship. Huh? Yeah. Truth and worship. Huh? Yeah. And this is what Papa's wanting. Yeah. This is what he wants. Looking for somebody to worship him in the Holy Ghost and in truth. He's just looking for the worship that's true. Yeah. And it's all working in cooperation with the one who's in us and with us. The world can't receive them. The world can't know him. If you're occupied with the world and the things of the world, if you think like the world, you can't think like him. If you agree with the world, if you process like the world, if you behave like the world, if we put you in a room and we watch you walk around like any other worldly person and you act and have the same behavior and the same outward expressions and the same responses as anybody else from the world in your classroom or in your workroom or in your shopping room, then you're of the world and you can't think like God. And you can't receive anything from them. And Father's here. God the Holy Ghost has come so that we won't walk like the world, talk like the world, think like the world, that we don't live after the realm of natural thinking, because we can now function in the mind of Christ, which is functioning in what? The Word of God. Hallelujah. Well, I'm working my way to be able to tell you about how to begin to move in faith. I want you to understand, there is absolutely nothing more important than you learning how to worship. There's nothing more important than you learn how to worship. Because if you learn how to worship, if you learn how to be inspired by the Word of God, you'll understand how to overcome every temptation, deal with everything that Satan comes at you with, deal with every one of the lies, all the craziness. If there was a meter put on most people's mind, there would be like maybe 0.001% truth and the rest of it's all just lies. Those are Holy Ghost Pentecostal people. Just think about the rest of the world. Think about the rest of the world. On a daily scale, okay? You know, when you think about who really is waking up in the morning and they start their day saying, Holy Spirit, I thank you that you're with me and that you're in me. I thank you that you come to lead me and guide me. I thank you, Father, that your life and your glory here abides with me, that you come to dwell on the inside of me, that your presence is here to be expressed like a wellspring and flow out like rivers. And here I am, I'm giving myself to you to walk in your word because you fully empowered me to do everything that you want me to do, that you purpose me to do. And I'm just going to dwell and live in your love, and I'm going to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, because I want to continue to be filled with all your fullness. I'm going to continue to live over here in how you feel about me and be secure and being bold and being so confident, just living over here and dwelling in your love, because he that dwells in love dwells in you, and I'm dwelling in you. I'm dwelling in God. I'm living out the life of God. I'm living the God kind of life. No, it usually starts very different from that. Now, you're going to have to be willing to change, because this is the school of the Spirit. And the school of the Spirit is where God the Holy Ghost comes to teach you and I how to do the Word, how to live the Word. And it's not doing all the things that people think that is so important, that denominationalism has taught men, that religion has taught men, that Christian religion has taught men. It's doing those things which the Word of God describes, that the Holy Ghost has come to make a living reality in our life, manifested in our life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's true. Amen. You agree. Amen. You believe. Amen. Amen. Because that's where it begins. Hallelujah. Trusting God. This trust. Hallelujah. Disagreement with him. Maraya. And then the knowing how he feels about you creates this great confidence and this great boldness. And then that explodes into a greater dimension of something else that he gave us. He gave us a measure of faith. That explodes over into a realm of fullness of faith, because faith grows. Why? Because we stay over here in a place called love. Understand, where there's fear, there's no love. Or there's little of it. You're certainly not made perfect in love. And I feel sorry for you on the day of judgment. Because God has purpose that we dwell in his love and that we live in his love. So and be as he is in this world. I mean, to just know I am as he is in this world. I function and I give myself to living that way. I live myself to being conformed that way. I give myself to that same kind of speech, that same kind of thinking. I recognize that God has made available for me by my conscious willingness of agreement to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, to be endued with him. Hallelujah. To recognize, and that's every single day. I recognize who he is. I agree with him. It is by the expression of my words. I pray his word. I don't pray my words. You know, I love praying in the Holy Ghost. You know, build up yourself, strengthen yourself, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keeping yourself in the love of God. And understand this, that keeping yourself in the love of God and moving in the faith that God has for us are absolutely essential to have together. No love, no faith. Do you hear me? I want to say this again. Where love exists, fear can't exist. Read it. What would that be? That's like 1 John 4, is it 17 or 18? 1 John 4:17-18. So then you look at this and you say, where there's love, there's not going to be fear. What does love do? Love casts out what? All fear. It casts it out. It's like turning on the lights. Would you like to know how? Would you like to know how to turn on the lights in a dark room, in the realms of the spirit, when all of a sudden you begin to question whether or not God loves you? Because it's fear about whether or not God loves you. It's fear. It was first seen when Adam entered into an agreement with Satan, stepped over into darkness by disobedience, and ran and hid from the presence of God in fear. That's where it first began. And we were all our lifetime subject to fear because of this death. But God has done something wonderful for us. Hallelujah. He destroyed the devil. He destroyed him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and delivered us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He put within our heart the Son. He put within our hearts the Spirit of the Son, whereby we say, God is my dad. Hallelujah. Now, it doesn't take long reading these things, talking about these things, meditating upon these things to become very inspired. So inspired that you find yourself experiencing the oneness. Hallelujah. God wants us to be so integrated, so overwhelmed, so filled up with what He's doing that He gave us the revelation of oneness. But you know what? The gospel was preached to Israel, didn't profit them because it wasn't mixed with faith. Somebody's going to have to stand up and say, I'm one with God. I mean, He's in me and I'm in Him. I'm dwelling in Him. I'm dwelling in His love. I embrace this. He said it. I count Him faithful. I believe. I count Him true. I'm not going to deny Him. I'm going to deny every other accusation, every other offensive lying thing, every antichrist spirit, everything that would come and bring into question what God has said. I'm going to uphold God's truth and God's word. And God, when He sees somebody doing that for real, all heavens mobilized, come and help you. Hallelujah. Hello. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. If you could just worship more. You know what God wants. Here's what Father wants. Father wants His house to be filled with the worship and the praise of His people. This is what Father has purposed, that in our assembly that there is such worship there, that the manifest presence of God in that worship becomes that much stronger, that much more fully made manifest there in that place, being totally captivated and raptured in His presence. You lose track of yourself and the Holy Ghost takes control. And I'm telling you, all of these things that you've been declaring and saying is true, that you've given yourself over to, begins to be expressed through you. You don't need permission. You couldn't be quiet. You've been taken over. Gifts of the Spirit will flow like rivers. Love flows like rivers. Joyful, refreshing life. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The gifts of the Spirit. I mean, just think about it. The gifts of the Spirit. It's like towards the end of the meeting last night, or on Wednesday night, I knew somebody had some kind of a rash. And of course, a lot of people, you know, there was some kind of a skin problem. I knew God wanted to address it. And I knew a number of people came, and I'm sure that everybody got touched. But I mean, as soon as Bethany stood in front of me, I go, you're the one I was looking for. Because you're the one. I knew. Because I was focused in gifts of the Spirit. I was talking to the gift of the Spirit in the realm of a word of knowledge, okay, and in the realm of a gift of healing. Huh? She goes home. She gets excited because all the rashes completely disappeared. It's beautiful to be able to function. Sometimes we just pray because somebody said, come and pray. We don't have any special knowledge on it, and we just go to praying. There's where it's a mixed bag. Sometimes people get healed, some people don't. Sometimes people don't get healed. There's all kinds of dynamics of whether or not they're going to hook up with fear or whether they're going to hook up with love, whether they're going to hook up with faith or whether they're going to hook up with unbelief and doubt. Listen, it really has a lot to do with how you're going to worship. Show me some people who lavishly worship. Show me some people who do not withhold from God, who just give lavishly. They're just givers. They just live to give. It's just about giving. I'll show you some people who know how to flow in the Holy Ghost. I'll show you people who know how to receive from God. If it's anything different, if you're all in prison, encapsulated in this thick, crusty, kind of mildewed, stainy, ugly shell called self, it's a terrible way to live. Hallelujah. Papa's come to crack that nut. Hallelujah. Prasakaraneya. Hallelujah. He's going to bust that shell. But there's so many people, I've seen them in church most of my life, they're just so happy being sad. They're so happy being ornery, indifferent, argumentative, always got a problem, always got a fuss, always got something going in the background that's just nagging at them. just frustrating them. And the world gets to see this. Bobby wants to deliver you out of that. He wants to teach you how to enjoy the life he gave you. God gave us abundant life. And that is far more than what has been limited to. That abundant life and the release of that abundant life is first and foremost seen in some fundamental things that the Holy Spirit has come to teach us. He's poured in, God has poured in his love into our hearts by the Holy Ghost. Fundamentally, he's come to teach us how to disbelieve, to know and believe his love, how to dwell in his love, how to discern love, praise God, to discern love, that God loved us even when we hated him. God loved us even when we were offensive. God loved us even when we were enemies. God loved us when we didn't care anything about him, weren't seeking him, weren't wanting him. He loved us and he led us into that love, and he's going to keep us in that love. At some point in time, we need to respond. And the response is going to be the victory. The response is going to be the glorious outpouring of God's manifest presence and all that he's promised through our lives, rather than just sitting around the rest of your life in church like this. Amen. I've often thought to do a camera thing, you know, candid camera, reverse angle camera. Somebody said to me, they said, you know, we're watching all the meetings online. We'd really like to get different angles of the meeting. I said, I don't think you really do. I said, we ought to just keep it just one shot. Because if I gave you a different angle, what, you want a face angle of all the people? I mean, we got to search and hunt to find somebody full of the Holy Ghost for caught away in God. Huh? Come on now. But yet you have a responsibility now to respond to the one who is with you and in you, who's come to lead you and guide you. There is going to be a response. There's going to be a will. There's going to be an action. There's going to be a force of your will that says, no, this is what God has commanded me to do. This is the oil of joy that he's poured out upon me. This is the response to being bathed in a love and a glory that has no end. If God's children just start looking like they loved, my goodness. Hallelujah. You can tell somebody who's being loved, can't you? You see them walk in the door. Oh, somebody's fallen in love. You're in love. What's going on? Who is it? You have such a peaceful and contented look, and that's just in the natural. What happens when something supernatural happens where somebody really begins to respond to the fiery, glorious presence of God's love poured into a heart by the Holy Ghost? Yes. To so give themselves to living in and dwelling in it that is perfected in you. Oh, I just got to read that verse of scripture because somebody still doesn't. It's just like, I told Father, I said, okay, Lord, okay. It's many years ago. Okay, even though they don't respond to your word, I'm going to just continue to preach it. I'm just going to continue to declare it just like you do. I'll do it faithfully because I want to please you. And reality of it is people don't respond to his word because you got all this other stuff going on. You got all this other valuable stuff. And if you really look at it, if you could just jump ahead 10,000 years, if you could just jump ahead 200 years from now and look at the stuff that's got your heart all wrapped around in knots, that's got you all knotted up, all tied up emotionally, all messed up psychologically, you would burn it. You'd burn the boot. You'd burn it. You'd burn it. You'd get a fire going and you would burn it. You would get it done. You'd say, I can't even believe it. Can anybody be that detached from reality? We are. We detached from reality. Truth. The truth of God is reality. We're attached to an illusion, a temporal existence that has no real value or meaning other than the choices that we're making to choose to live the way that God lives or not. Because he's given us an opportunity to choose to be like him, to live the way he lives, and he's brought all the force of heaven. He's brought all of the power and all the provision, all by his own divine power, all the strength, all the ability. But reality of it is constantly people are continually on this path where they're choosing cares of this life, they're choosing deceitfulness of riches, they're choosing to be entangled with the affairs of this life that grip them, that grip their emotions, that grip their passions, that grip their interests, that grip their desire, and they just can't be happy about God because they're too sad about their stuff. Now, if my stuff can make me happy, I'll be happy about God for as long as my stuff will make me happy. But it needs to be completely, it needs to be, not reversed, it needs, one needs to be eliminated because you can't serve God and mammon. You can't walk in the Holy Ghost and walk in you. You can't take care of the interest of heaven and seek the things of heaven and seek your own earthly interest. You cannot. And I'm going to keep telling you, because I'm going to tell you right now, this is the school of the Spirit, and this is what the Holy Ghost says, and he's looking at a lot of people that are sitting down on the ground saying, I want to run. He said, well, you just stand up. Oh, I want to run in the Spirit. Well, will you just stand up? Well, I want to run. I want to run. Well, would you just stand up? But I want to run. Oh, God, what hinders me from being running? Standing up. Oh, God, I want to move with you. What hinders me from moving with you? Stand up. Not wanting to start at the beginning. Not wanting to recognize, wait a minute, I need to let go of me and my own life. I need to let go of my own ideas, of my own decisions, my own purpose, and my own interests, so I'm not constantly being yanked around by the powers of darkness through that attachment to earthly things. Tonight, I would pray and believe God for you that you'd get a Holy Ghost scissors. Hallelujah. Just a Holy Ghost sword, the Word of God, and just start cutting all those earthly interests and say, I'm done. Hallelujah. I'm going to live in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit. And this just begins. It's going to begin. God's here to help you. He's amazing. Anybody who would just even, half-heartedly respond to him, he just works. Even people won't respond with him. He still continues to deal with them, continues to bang on the door and knock at their door. This half-hearted response. All this, I'm not really willing to let go. I'm not willing really to willing fully to trust you, God. I'm not willing to trust you on a level that it's going to risk my life. Well, you know what? You can't even move into faith until you trust first. And you're never going to trust until there's a relationship love, a relationship that brings a trust love. Hallelujah. A trust love will explode into faith. Ooh. It will explode faith in life, because with that trust love that he's given to us, he's put it in the heart, he's also given us a measure of faith so that it can grow, but it's never going to grow until we'll start saying, okay, what you said in your word, oh God, is what you purposed me to do in order to lay hold of and connect with you. Somebody said, how do I connect with the Holy Ghost? Do the word. How do I connect with the Holy Ghost? Do the word. How do I connect with faith? Do the word. Is there anything more important than moving in faith? The gift of faith is exploits that we read about in Hebrews chapter 11 that are so amazing. I look at faith as faith, whether it's being expressed as a gift of faith or whether it's being expressed as just as, Jesus described it in Mark chapter 8, the centurion described it in Mark chapter 8, or how Jesus described it in Mark chapter 11. I mean, you know what? Faith is faith. I mean, it, a little bit of it, you could say this mountain be removed and cast into the sea. I would say that qualifies as what most people define as a gift of faith. I mean, that's just about as miraculous and supernatural as you could possibly ever imagine. The Lord says, I want to bring you to a place where whatever you ask, I'll do it. He wants intimacy. He wants intimacy. He wants intimacy. And you can't hold on to all your stuff and have intimacy with him. You can't make yourself the object of your own trust. You can't withhold from God and have intimacy with him. You can't be all these things that the self realm dictates for you to be. And have intimacy with him. So you're going to have to start learning intimacy. You just start worshiping him. Somebody said, I want to deliver. The other day, this person said to me, I want to be delivered from this harassing, tormenting thing. I said, it's just an evil spirit. I said, it's easy to have authority over evil spirits. But the reality of it is you're going to have to be willing to walk with God. I can deliver you from the evil spirit as easy as saying, be delivered. Go now in Jesus' name. Or just to say to you, free. You're free now in Jesus' name. But now there's going to be a response in your life, because you're going to go back and you're going to face the same situations and you're going to face the same challenges and you're going to face the same circumstance. And at some place you're going to have to stop going with you and going with what pops in your head at the time, all your fight, flight stuff. Must I repeat all of that? Because you need it. Good thing it's taped. Amen. Somebody said, I can't keep up with all the concepts. Oh, you don't need to. Get rid of your head anyways. Just start grabbing a hold of it with your heart. Your thinking's got you where you're at right now. Father wants you to stop. He wants you to just grab a hold of the Word of God. I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost is able to bring all these things back to your remembrance. He will. It's true. You just got to let go. He'll make you smarter than you've ever been. When you stop, He'll make you smarter. I'm the mind of Christ, the mind of the Spirit. To have the mind of Christ, to have the mind of the Spirit, to walk in the mind of Christ, to walk in the mind of the Spirit, to walk in the knowledge of God, to walk in the understanding of the Almighty, to walk in His wisdom, to walk in His counsel. I mean, what better thing could we possibly want to achieve? What better thing should we study for? God, the Holy Spirit, He's with us and He's in us. Hallelujah. He has nothing to do with the world. The world cannot know Him. The world cannot receive Him. You know, but praise God, we're not of the world, even as Jesus is not of the world. Jesus said, you can't hear my words because you're of the world. I'm not of the world. You are of the world. I'm from above. You're from beneath. Then He looks over at us and says, you're from above too. Hallelujah. You used to be from beneath, but now you're from above. You're not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. The prince of the world comes and he has nothing in me. We have had this oneness with God. It is amazing. Didn't earn it. It's a gift. It was given to us. But somehow we fall short of being willing to embrace it because we say, oh, that's wonderful, God. Now let me go back to counting my little peas. Now let me go back to managing my little acorns. Now let me go back to managing my little meager life and count up my little, you know, grains of sand again to make sure I've got enough. The stuff that we trust in that is foolish. It has no value. It has no meaning. So I said it has value because I've got to take it to the store. And it may not be worth anything, but I've got to take it to the store in order to sustain my physical life so that I can eat. Oh, no, you don't. That's a lie, too. Because God will show you how you trust Him. You go all the way with Him. He'll show you how to multiply loaves and fishes. You trust Him and He'll show you how to step into riches that go beyond what Solomon had. Solomon didn't have riches because he inherited it from his dad. He had riches because God made him rich. Abraham didn't have riches because he inherited it from his dad. He had riches because God made him rich. Because he was willing to walk out the walk of trusting God. Not even a life of faith. Not in the supernatural level in which the Holy Spirit is supplying to us the way He is right now. There is no way that He had the same level of opportunity that you and I have right now with the Holy Ghost having been here with us right now. Jesus said, I got to go away and be glorified before He can come. But when I'm gone, He'll come. Right now you don't have Him, but you will have Him. He'll be with you and in you. Come on now. Think about this. Come on now. School of the Spirit. Father wants to show us how to begin. We got to understand how to enjoy the beginning. The beginning is right over here in this love of God manifest, living and dwelling in His love. And what is that going to produce? It's going to produce extravagant worship. So get started with whatever you know about His love right now, because you worship based upon the revelation of the love of God you have right now. And you cannot in any way move in anywhere beyond that revelation. That revelation of His love carries you into His fullness. Whatever revelation of God you have, that's where you're at. Whatever limitation you have on that love of God, that is your restraint. God does not restrain. God does not withhold. God, the Holy Spirit, is here to show us this wonderful love. This love of God has been manifested. This love of God is here. It's now something you and I grab a hold of. He's given us a measure of faith to believe it, to know it, to cooperate with it, and to choose whether to dwell in it and abide there, to have the authority of God to run off every harassing, tormenting spirit that would say otherwise. And I'm going to tell you, it's in worship. It's in just stopping and saying, Lord, just write your own little song. Oh, God, you love me more than I love me. I don't really fully understand about it. No, you do. You know what? Oh, God, and it'd be better not to get into the doubt. It'd be better to stay over here and just, God, you love me. Oh, you so love me. And I love you too. And just stay there. I love you, Lord, and we worship you. Oh, I love you, Lord. Just stay there. And then don't stop doing that and snap at somebody standing around by near to you. Because you can't, the way you love God's people and the way you love those who are anointed of God, Father says, is the way that you love Him. It's true. No man can say, because one here, once again, I'm still over here in that same context, right? I think I'm in verse 19 of 1 John chapter 4 now. You know, you can't say you love God whom you haven't seen and you don't love your brother whom you have seen. This love is going to be expressed through us. This love, if it's real, a love that we have for God, it is measured and understood by God Himself on the basis of how we love each other, how we love the brethren. And then it goes to another level on how we love the anointing, how we love the giftings of God around us. Huh? Huh? Come on, people. Look, I mean, I tell you right now, there's some of you so bottled up with yourself. I believe if I didn't say hi to some of you, just walk by and just never would even say nothing. Because you just bottled up with yourself. You bottled up with offense. You bottled up with unforgiveness. You bottled up with self-interest. You bottled up with your own ideas. You need to get delivered. You need deliverance. Amen. You need to be delivered. God, the Holy Spirit, is very clear on the issue. I'm amazed at how many people all across the gamut in Christendom all believe they have the truth. And it seems to be rare that it's measured based upon the Word of God and the proofs of God's Word. It's all just subjective. It's all just ideas. It's all just touchy-feely what I think, because you are God in your own eyes. And you'll never understand this wonderful realm so long as you're stuck in that imprisonment of deception and demonic oppression. God, the Holy Ghost, He's amazing, isn't He? He's so faithful. He's so merciful. He continues to bang at the door of our heart. He continues to cry out. He continues to say, come. He continues to lead us to Jesus. He continues to lead us to the Word. He continues to show us how to walk in mercy, how to walk in forgiveness, how to walk in this place of no offense. All we've got to do is be willing to learn. Somebody say, how am I going to do that? Worship. Let me see you worship. Let me see you dance. Huh? Let me see you praise Him. Let me see an empty vessel before God. I'll show you one. Somebody who's worshiping lavishly. Huh? I tell you right now, they can move into that place. I tell you, they're the most easy and most comfortable person to be around. You know, Satan constantly comes and creates lies. There are people that are oppressed by demon spirits. They are constantly having demonic powers running interference saying, oh, that person doesn't like you. That itself is a familiar spirit at work in the lives of so many people, creating division. That isn't even supposed to exist and would not exist in someone's life who's full of the Spirit of the Lord. Those things are immediately dissolved. They can't have no impact upon you. Huh? And even if it were true, it doesn't even matter to you, because you're going to behave the same way, because you're compelled by the love of God. You under the authority of the love of God. The love is you're dwelling in it, and in dwelling in it is expressed through you. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as He is, so are we in this world. And how was He? He came to lay down His life for everybody who did anything wrong, for those who hated Him, for those who despised Him, for those who didn't want Him around, didn't want anything to do with His leadership, didn't want anything to do with His ideas, didn't want anything to do with His ways. And this is who He is, and this is who we are supposed to be. Amen. People walking around in fear. Fear has torment, doesn't it? That's what creates that sorrow and that sad look. That's what creates. You just look at people. You just look. You don't need me to point it out. Huh? Just take a picture. Just take a snapshot of yourself on a daily basis. Do I look like I'm walking in love? Do I look like I am free, or am I in bondage? Am I in bondage to free being defined by on the basis, are you imprisoned to fear? Because that has a tormented look, a depressed, sorrowful, anxious, hurting, worried, concerned look. All these things which God says is not supposed to be in our life. Or is that person liberated? Are they free? That means they're bathing, captivated by the love of God. Nothing matters but His love, dwelling in that love. That is the liberty now where it is literally the launching pad to living out the life of God. It's the launching pad to revealing heaven. It's the launching pad for all of the works of faith. We understand, according to what Paul said in Galatians chapter 6, I believe, verse 15, he said, circumcision doesn't matter anything. Uncircumcision doesn't matter anything. All that matters, all your religion, all your ideas about religion, about what pleases God, what's clean and what's unclean, doesn't matter. All that matters is faith, which works by love. And he equates that to the new creation, because he uses the same preface to ultimately derive a conclusion that is expressed in the same in a similar manner. One, he expresses it by saying faith which works by love, and the other he says a new creation. A new creation is supposed to have faith which works by love. Amen. And love is supposed to be spotty. It's not supposed to, huh? Come on now. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 How we praying, oh God, bring a great move of God. You're supposed to be the move of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's supposed to be the move of God. When God gets there, what is it going to look like? When you show up on his behalf. What's that going to look like? Huh? You going to organize the papers? The chairs? Huh? You going to put everybody in their little rows? Huh? Oh, are you going to bring heaven? Do you have heaven? God the Holy Spirit has come to make it certain that you have heaven. God the Holy Spirit has come to establish us in something that is just so amazing, so wonderful. If we would give ourselves to having what Father wants, then what we're going to say, what we're going to give ourselves to, is we're going to give ourselves to the song that we were singing Wednesday night when we left. Let the sun shine. Let the sun shine. Let the sun shine. No more cloudy days. Let the sun shine in the brightness of noonday. Because he's called us to stand up, to arise and shine, for our light has come. What is he telling us to do? Once again, he's telling us to represent him, to look like heaven, to be freed now in his love, in this fellowship, in this union, in this place where there is no condemnation, where there is no shame, where there is no separation, where there is no offense, where you are fully his, he is fully yours, where you are fully empowered by him. You got his sign sealed and delivered approval called the Holy Ghost. Amen. And now you walking around and you feeling good all the time. Everybody else is devastated, like, woo, it's good. We're all fired. Praise God. Father's going to take care of us. You're not moved by the same things that everybody else is moved by. Unfortunately, that is not the witness. Unfortunately, the church acts just like the world is moved by the same fears, by the same challenges, by the same issues. And it's not supposed to be that way. We're supposed to rise and shine. Because our light has come, we're supposed to be the light of the world. In other words, we're supposed to be heaven on earth. Amen. Because we're the celestial city. That's the light of the world. It's the celestial city. Amen. It's the heavenly city. Hallelujah. Which you and I are supposed to already be citizens of and seated in the heavenly realm with. But that's a faith realm. What is a faith? How is a faith realm going to work? How is faith going to be principally activated in our life? Because we're going to be willing to be over here in confident love of God, the love that God has for us. Hallelujah. I have the fear of the Lord, which is clean. It's part of the Holy Ghost. It's not a fear that has torment that came into Adam's life when he was separated from God. I have the fear of the Lord that's taught me to hate evil. I have the fear of the Lord that brings it to me into my life an awe of who he is, an awe, a revelation of God. Hello. Are you with me here? But when it comes to fear of judgment, I have none. I'm in love. I'm being loved. If I went off into sin and wickedness, I should have a fear of judgment. If I went off serving myself, if I thought in any place, there was any place in my life where I wasn't doing what God said for me to do, I was holding on to myself, I would have a fear of judgment. I'd want to get right because I got this right spirit on the inside of me saying, get right. I wouldn't justify it. Because I'm not of the world. I'm not going to think like the world and justify wrongdoing and wrong behavior and sin. I'm not going to hold on to my own life. I'm not going to work it out for myself. If what you're saying God is leading you to do, that the Holy Ghost is leading you and directing you to do, you got to sit and think it through. It ain't God. It ain't God. Because he doesn't work that way. You know, did you just read in the scripture where the Lord draws out a map and gives you all the various details and paragraphs of each step you used to take and says, here it is. Now that's the plan. He'll walk it out. God doesn't work that way. Man works that way. Man works that way. God doesn't work that way. If God tells you to do it, you're supposed to get up and do it. If God says go to Kashmir, go to Kashmir. You don't have to understand. You don't have to figure out anything. Just get on an airplane and go. You don't have to worry about the money, concern yourself about the money. Just get on an airplane and go. Huh? And if you get to the airport and you still don't have any money, Father will bring the person with the money. I guarantee you. He's done it for others. He'll do it for you. I've not had to go that far. I've just had Father tell me, go. And then I'm going to go. I start moving to go. Somebody says, have you bought your ticket yet? I haven't bought your ticket, my ticket. Why haven't you bought your ticket yet? Because the Lord hadn't told me to buy the ticket. Literally. Well, shouldn't you be planning this out? Wouldn't you get a better ticket price if you bought the ticket out 2 months in advance? No. I'm going to buy the ticket when God tells me to buy the ticket. It comes as a surge, as a divine Holy Ghost urge from heaven, just like prophecy, just like the shout, just like the worship, just like the praise, just like any other gifts of the Spirit. And then I go buy the ticket. And when I go buy the ticket, I've got the money and I get the best price. Every time. Every time. Well, are you going to learn how to be led by the Holy Ghost, or are you going to continue to walk in your own way? Because are you going to be in the school of the Spirit? Are you going to hold on to yourself because you withhold? You cannot give. You cannot give liberally. You cannot give generously. You cannot trust God. You cannot walk up. There's too afraid. You're afraid. It's scary. Mom said don't do it. Dad said don't do it. Advisor said don't do it. Counselor said don't do it. Brother said don't do it. Sister said don't do it. Maybe even pastor said don't do it. But God says, I want you to trust me with a total abandonment of your life. I want you to lose your life. I want you to lose your life. If you're willing to lose your life, you're willing. If you're truly willing to lose your life, if you've lost your life, everything else is secondary. Somebody comes to you and puts a gun to your head, says, give me everything you have. You'll give it to them because you value your life more than all the things that you have. So therefore, if God really has your life, he has all your stuff. And then you have to deal with that because this is the school of the Spirit. He's not playing pretend. He's not going to sit around and listen to your explanation and say, wow, I didn't even think of that. You're right. Good point. His word is non-negotiable. It is absolute. It's absolute truth. It is unchanging. It abides forever. You are going to pass away. Your life is but a handbreadth. You're going to turn back to dust and ash, and God's not going to miss a beat. He endures forever. He will not stop, and neither will his word. His word will continue on being provable over and over again, long past your existence and my existence. You and I just get an opportunity to participate with it in this short period of time. And you're going to decide what you're going to participate with and how you're going to do it. You're either going to be led by you and by your culture and by what you believe, or you're going to be led by the Holy Ghost. And God's word perfectly defines that. And it's about you losing your life at every turn and every point. And that's about you being willing to trust God and risk everything in following him. Oh, yeah. And I should have had a whole lot bigger amen than that. Because a huge amen would have come, because there's only the Spirit of truth here, it would have come out of a participation that's where you're at. Because when you've laid your life down, you feel it. Do you want to walk in the school of the Spirit, or do you want to play pretend? You want just half salvation, or do you want the whole thing? You want a portion, or do you want the fullness? I think people are like portions. I'll just give me a portion. I'll just take a double portion. I don't want the fullness. Fullness means everything. Abandonment, complete surrender over to God. Portion, I get to hang on to something of me. But even those who had a portion got rid of everything of them. Elisha being the example. Wow. Can't you just see Elisha? He said, well, Elijah, give me some time. I need to go calculate. I need to go figure up. I need to understand how mom and the family is going to take care of themselves and how we're going to be able to hold on to the farm. Because all the income that we've been getting is from my 12 yoke of oxen, you know, and I've got to figure out whether or not I can actually go and offer them up, and make them kindling to offer up the oxen as a sacrifice unto God and create a banquet for the neighborhood. Did you see that? No, he didn't do that. He was ready for the call. He was ready. He's like, I want God more than anything. He was ready. He had to be ready. I want God more than anything. I want God more than anything. You guys got to take care of her. I don't want to have a lopsided relationship with her. Lopsided relationships where I'm always correcting her on the front row and I don't get to see her except for on the front row. And I'm always having to correct her on the front row. She sees me and all I'm doing is correcting her. You with me?
Yeah.
Many people have that kind of lopsided relationship with the Lord. You need to get over in the love. You need to get over in the fellowship. You need to get out of the condemnation. You just need to let go. The only reason you have any condemnation is because you're not willing to let go. The only reason people have guilt and condemnation is because they're not willing to repent and get right. Huh? Because Jesus came to deliver us from us, deliver us from condemnation and guilt and shame, because he came to give to us through the act of repentance a whole new life of well-being, of oneness and unity with God, so that you and I can be in him, he in us, and we're now empowered. We're good. Yeah. I don't need to do anything. I'm a worship. Paul wants worship. He wants worship, and he wants truth. He doesn't want lie in me. He doesn't want falsehood. He doesn't want make-believe. He doesn't want my word. He wants his word. There's nothing. I want to help you understand something tonight. There is no other definition of truth but God's word. Your ideas are not a definition of truth. Your logical explanation of things is not a definition of truth, and it never will be. Can I get that through to you tonight? If you want to take a note, take that one. Can I get that through to you tonight? Can I get that through to you tonight? Really?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
You had truly become a student of the Spirit if I could just get that through to you tonight. God's word alone is truth. That's it. Jesus himself and who he is and what he showed and what he said and what he declared is the truth, and there is no other truth. Jesus said, I am the truth. I am the way. I am the life. This is it. This is how it works. This is how you come to the Father. No man can come to the Father but like this. But by me, I'm the only one that can give you truth. I'm the only one that can give you this life. I'm the only one that can establish you in this way. And we're sitting around figuring, and we're sitting around thinking, because we're not hungry enough. We're not just desperate to have God. We're not sitting in that place ready, ripe for the picking, so that God can say to the prophet, go anoint Elisha to take your place. Because God already searched the heart. It wasn't a random pick. He saw a man plowing with 12 yoke of oxen, saying, oh God, I want to serve you. Oh God, but I could just give myself continually. I could imagine who Elisha was. At the time the work was done, I guarantee you he was one of those people who were stood by night in the house of the Lord, who came to bless the Lord, who gave himself to looking upon the word of God and thinking about Enoch and thinking about Abraham and thinking about the mighty men that was revealed in Judges, and thinking about, you know, one of his probably ancestors, Joshua, just caught away with the possibilities of being used by God, of being living in that realm where the Messiah rules and is king over everything. And you can just see the contemplation of his heart. You know, obviously, this was the meditation of his heart. This was the delight of his heart. This was the passion of his life, the desires of his life. So Father's going to answer his prayer. That's all that was going on. It wasn't a random pick. People think it's just some random selection. No, it's not some random selection. It's God responding to a hungry and thirsty soul. God, the Holy Spirit, can only lead and guide a hungry and thirsty soul, wanting to be led and guided, desperate to be led and guided. He cannot speak to a heart that is just set on doing it their own way. If there's anything that I've discovered that God is constantly training me in, is how to be more sensitive, to be led and guided by him, even on the smallest of details, to be sensitive to him. Sometimes I discover myself and I go, oh my goodness, I can't believe, oh God, that I plowed forward headlong in my own thinking, even though if you would have looked at me from any perspective, you would have thought he's waiting upon God. Look how sensitive he is to the Lord. And in that midst of sensitivity, the Lord is showing me how I'm plowing my way forward headlong into my own will and purpose and what I think God wants to do, rather than listening to him to be led and be guided by the one who's come to be with me and who's in me, who's filled me with his glory, who surrounds me with his baptismal anointing. You're in the school of the Spirit. Do you want to be?
Yes.
You showed up tonight.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. They're in the school of discipline. They're in the school of learning how to act right. And it's pretty funny. It's pretty hysterical. And there are rules to really getting it established. And it's like management. Constantly. It's putting out fires. You know, it's like, you know, it's crisis management. It's right. It's one fire drill after the next. It's one emotional outburst after the next. It's one correction after the next. How about you? Are you in the process? Is there anybody correcting you? Is there anybody leading you? Is there anybody shaping you? Is there anybody helping you? Is there anyone that you look to? Is there any passion in your heart to get it right?
Yes.
That works out in how you respond right here to the voice that God places in your midst. how you respond to apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers, and especially those pastors, those leadership that is in your life that God has specifically placed there to establish you and to perfect you. Because there's a lot of people who will not respond. They hold all kinds of various different things that are opposite to love, which therefore shuts them out, cuts them off from being led and guided by the Holy Ghost. Cuts them off. Because if you can't be instructed by the Spirit of the Lord that is in a man, you can't be instructed by the Holy Ghost. And it's happening. God puts all of these things that He is doing supernaturally on a proof basis that is very practical, that has witnesses coming and going right and left in our life by those that are around us, that are with us. It's tough, but you're learning how not to do it your way. It's tough. She has her will. She has her way. And she's fighting the leadership right now because she wants to go with Dad and Naomi. It's an escape. It's an adventure. It's a fun thing. But it's not going to be fun when they get there. She just thinks it is. If she really knew what was going to happen when she get there, she wouldn't want to go because it might happen to her. Are you with me? We're all the same thing. It's all the same things going on, the same dynamic. It's the same dynamic. It's absolutely the same dynamic. People want to come along, oh, just leave them alone. Oh, just let them be. Yeah, just let them ultimately grow up and develop to resist the Holy Ghost and do it their own way. That's why fathers talk to us about child discipline, why it's important to train a child properly. Because it's really going to ultimately be about how we are trained as children to respond to the Holy Spirit, to respond to the living God, to respond to the one who is above all, the judge of all, who's in the unseen realm, whom we've not seen. But praise God, now we have fully, He's fully been revealed through Christ Jesus. We have a place, people, we have a position. You and I have a responsibility that those in the Old Testament did not have because we have received far more than they had. We have a responsibility that goes far beyond those that were before the law in the days of Abraham and before. Far, far greater responsibility because we've received far more. We've actually seen and had witness to us God fully revealed and manifested in the person Christ Jesus. And He sent the Holy Ghost who's here living with us. He's given us His word, something that they didn't have. He's given us His detailed word by word, sentence by sentence, paragraph by paragraph, instruction on how to walk in all of His ways, how to step over into an unlimited display of faith where every impossible thing becomes possible, a relationship where everything that we ask He will do. Yes. Because our heart does not condemn us. Yes. Because we do those things that are pleasing in His sight, and that is all there in the context of walking in this love, dwelling in this love. Oh, being built up in this love, not allowing any unforgiveness, not allowing strife, not allowing offense, not allowing fear, not allowing any of that stuff. A place that comes to us because the Holy Ghost poured this love in our lives, and out of this that He has poured into us, there is a wellspring springing and a river flowing of His love that we just say, I'm going to give myself to the love. I'm not going to behave myself like wicked men. Hello. We got a model of what's not wicked. Jesus. We have a model. We have one model of that which is righteous. Jesus. And praise God for His word, because every one of His words are righteousness. It's righteous. Every one of His words are pure. That's the only model. All of His works, all that He's doing. Ha soparaneia. Say hallelujah. Lift your hands and praise God. I'm going to tell you, if you just get into excitement and worship, dance around, you won't get all frustrated and aggravated and all knotted up with your self-interest. Amen. To the point that you're just so fighting it, fighting Dad. But I love it. I need to make a movie of this because this is the dynamic of people's relationship with Father. It's the dynamic of the relationship with the Holy Ghost. Father's calling you out. Listen to people. There are people here tonight. Satan has created for you lies, and it's an oppression, and he's created for you barriers that don't even exist. They're your own making. It's an illusion by a demonic realm. Comes out of your own offense and your own unforgiveness. Comes out of your own stubbornness and your own certainty of what you believe. I promise you, you don't want to believe in yourself or trust yourself. I promise you that you want to come to a place that you don't know anything of yourself and can do nothing of yourself. I promise you. Your intelligence and your wisdom and your ideas and the way you think it works, it needs to become to you something so horrible and horrific. Because all it's going to do is work more of the same in your life. Destruction and disaster and problems. Huh? Listen, dear people, wouldn't it be a wonderful thing if we could have enough love to one another that we could walk around and look at each other and go, false witness. That big old frown and ugly look that you have on your face when you're worshiping, false witness. People walk in, I watched the lost walk by you and take a double take. They were wondering if you were sick and was in need of 911. False witness. God the Holy Spirit wants to lead us, but we've got to be willing to be led. What does he want us to lead? What does he want to lead us into? He wants to first and help us to quit struggling and fighting him. Because it is not as overt as Ruth as Anna is with Joshua right now. It's not as overt. But nonetheless, it's still just as repulsive, and it's still just as it exists just that way. I personally would have already tore her little fanny up. But Joshua can do it his own way, and he has the right to do it his own way. Because, you know, my bigger interest is creating that place of submission, total submission. I know that if I can come to a place of total submission, I can have everything the Father wants for me. I know if my children are a place of submission to God, they're going to be protected, and they're going to have everything that God wants for them. And so it's a bigger dynamic than whether or not they're being the model kids or whether or not they're behaving themselves properly. It really comes down to, at the end of the day, we want you to be blessed. Yes. Amen. Why do we have to struggle with you over your bad attitudes? Recognizing them, repenting, and not willing to walk that way anymore. Why? Why do we have to make it a fight? Why do you so desperately want to hold on to your badness? Why do you so desperately want to hold on to your pain and your hurt and your wrongness? You would think that you just tell people, say, look, this is what's going on in your life. You don't want that. And they say, I don't want it. And they would repent and say, train me. I want to learn. How do I do it right? And the Lord say, I want you to walk in joy continually. Rejoice continually. Rejoice forevermore. When's the last time you read the Psalms? How many times do you hear the joy over and again? Just read the Psalms continually. Just read it. It'll help you. Got to say, look, I want you to see what I want you to be. You might have to read it 1,000 times before you get it. I don't know. Sometimes the learning curve is very slow because deception is very thick. Wow. So it's so hard for people to realize it's their responsibility to walk around with a smile, to be pleasant. When somebody walks up to them, to be pleasant, to be warm, to be loving. Now, I'm going to tell you, I recognize your people that when someone walks up to you and they have an offense against you, and there's things going on, demonic things going on, I understand that that's going to be challenging. But however, God's going to give you the ability, He'll give you the supply to where that you can just eliminate that. Just eliminate, just hallelujah. You can move in the behavior that ultimately is going to produce a faith. That ultimately is going to make everything that is impossible possible. However, there's that juncture every time. Are you going to be led and are you going to be guided? Somebody said, I want to be led and I want to be guided. Okay, well, can I bring it down to you another level? Are you willing to obey? Are you willing to do what God said to do? Are you willing to stop doing what you say to do and what you believe to do and what you think is right and start doing what God said to do and what God thinks is right? Because this is the hardest thing. This is what keeps everyone back. This is the school of the Spirit. Hallelujah. Everything that Papa's done is all about love. All of his law, all of his testimony, everything just fulfills right there in that love. And it's not about how people love you. It has nothing to do with how people love me. Well, I can just think about somebody. It has nothing to do with how people love you. It's a false perception. Because you can never even interpret that. It's about how you love. How well are you loving? And that love, we discern the love. We can understand the love because the love is defined for us. It's defined in Christ Jesus. And so we ought to love the brethren as well. And the way that we love God is the way that we love the brethren. And so how are we going to learn? Now, that's the word of God. Now, how are we going to learn to give ourselves to that flow? How are we going to learn how to walk in that direction and that obedience? I say worship. I say give yourself to the word of God because it's spirit and life and it produces an inspiration in you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, I have a great life. I have a wonderful life that you should actually covet. I got to spend most of the day in the Word. I got to spend most of the day, hallelujah, just giving myself to the Lord. Of course, I stopped at about 3 o'clock, started doing counseling at about 3. Did counseling from 3 to 6:30 today. But, I mean, that's just, once again, I'm flowing in the Holy Ghost. It's a coveted life. Huh? I'm not living for myself, and I don't ever want to live for myself. And Father's just looking for anybody who wants to live this way. And as soon as he finds somebody, he's going to fill him with his Holy Ghost. Because being filled with the Holy Ghost is for the simple purpose of being empowered to go do the works of Jesus. But you've got to be willing to be led by the Holy Ghost. Why should you be baptized in the Holy Ghost if you're not willing to be led by him? Are you with me?
Yeah.
Yeah. That doesn't make any sense, does it? If you're not being willing to be moved by him and be sensitive to him and be taught to be sensitive to him, to do it only his way, to refuse to do it your way, to refuse to respond out of any self-interest or out of the ways that other people would respond or the world would respond. What value is it to even be baptized in the Holy Ghost in a greater way? I love what Pastor Pedro Ibarra said. The anointing, that level of the anointing will kill you. You better learn how to walk with God. Because if God were to bless you, to step you into that level of anointing, then those spiritual violations would have far greater consequences in your life. And I believe that. I see that in the scripture. I have no problem with that. I think it's all the more reason that we walk in a greater awe of God. Not a fear that has torment. A fear that has torment is a fear that questions his love for us. You understand that?
Yes.
It questions whether or not we're protected. It questions whether or not we're provided for. It questions whether or not his best interest is ours, whether we're really his friends, whether he's there for us, that he's going to be our help in time of need. That's the fear that has torment. Oh, there's another kind of fear. It's a holy fear. It's the fear that has this is an awe of who he is, that is an awe of his power and of his glory and of his majesty. And that anointing is so associated with this. Understand me, this anointing. I do not want to learn anything that is going to make the anointing, that is going to make the sacred things of God common or ordinary. I don't want to learn it. If what's being preached isn't going to create within me hunger and thirst and passion for walking in his holiness, I want nothing to do with it. If it's a gift of the Spirit that's being manifested, if it's not bringing me to a revelation of the Word of God, I want nothing to do with it because there's all kinds of lying signs and wonders. So I would like to bring every one of you along. I'd like to see every one of you walk in the Spirit and do what God says to do. But at the end of tonight, it's about your will. It's about your routines. And the older you get, the harder it is going to be for you to change. Because that's just the way it is. A tree becomes hardened as it grows. It's true. Things become hardened. They become fossilized. They become imprinted. Oh, you want to give yourself, people. It's like I told Leslie the other night. It's not how old you are. It's how old you act. And I pray that you act like a child towards heaven. I pray that you're willing to just say, okay, yes, I'm going to do that. I will do that right now. Huh? If you're in a classroom and you're a teacher and you tell the child, put your pencil down right now, and they don't put their pencil down, you get all upset. But why don't you look at you? Do you put your pencil down when God the Holy Ghost speaks? Or do you just keep right on writing because you believe this is what you're going to do because you're an adult and you have a license to do whatever you want to do? Not me. I've come under the yoke. His yoke is easy, his burden is light. I've come under his servitude. I'm under my master. I'm under the sovereign ruler of the universe. I am completely subjected to obeying the master of all living beings. Hallelujah. The master of the universe. The sovereign ruler. Are you on your own? Do you just get to do whatever you want to do? I'm talking to you about the school of spirit because God the Holy Ghost is not going to move beyond the Word. You're going to understand how the movings of the Holy Ghost happen because of the Word. That Word of God is going to become real to you because you're going to obey it at every point. Not what's convenient for you, what's difficult for you. You're going to be willing to lay it all down. And it's going to be, it is exciting and a real thing for you to say, we thus judge, if one died for all, then all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. Hallelujah. Let me tell you, people, and I'm going to close with this. I know I said it in the last School of the Spirit. I'm going to say it again because it's very important, because there's some people that are at this crossroads again. There's folks at various different crossroads. You may be watching me by web tonight. You might even be here. Think about it. There are many times I've been in places where I've just had to battle with people because they were unwillingness to obey God, their unwillingness to listen, their unwillingness to repent was just its impact, its spiritual impact literally grabbed the attention of the whole meeting, of the whole issue, of the whole thing that God wanted to say and God wanted to do. And God wrestles with men and He pleads with men. And if our heart is right, we're going to respond and we're going to change. And if that response and that change is not measurable for someone else to see, you didn't respond and you didn't change. It's a make-believe. Truth has evidence. Truth is, you can evaluate it. People that don't want to be evaluated, they don't want to be transparent. They don't want someone to look into life and say, is it I? Am I the one? I have always, everybody, who doesn't need to come, who this doesn't even apply to, you immediately want to come to me and ask me, is it me? And that's the way it happens. I have people always come to me and say, is it I? No, it's not you. Just keep that heart. Because if it were you, you wouldn't want to come to me and ask me, is it me? And what must I do to change? Because that's the same spirit of stubbornness. That's the same spirit of defiance that is being addressed in the first place. Don't be unwilling to be soft and yielded and pliable to God. Don't be unwilling to respond to His Word, because He loves us so much. And He, praise God, He just won't stop. He'll wrestle with you till you die. But there's going to be a moment of time that you're going to breathe out your last breath, and then you're going to know. And all that you're going to know, you know what you're going to know right then? The Word of God is going to come with great force, because it's just going to be the Word. It's not going to be anything different. It's not going to be, oh, exception for so-and-so. Put the Word aside. Oh, this is an exception. No, no exception. It's just going to be the Word. This is what I said. It's unchanging. It's for all. It's everyone. The same message. Here, listen to me. In closing night, understand this. Here's what God's asking. He's asking for you and I to come to a place of being yielded to Him. Everybody who's ever had anything in God, has ever been able to move in God, who's ever been able to grow in God and mature in the gifts of the Spirit, mature in the character and nature of God. Once again, it's dwelling in it. You want more? You want to see greater healings take place in your life? Give yourself to praying for people to be healed. But before that, give yourself to dwelling in love. Because praying for people to be healed, there's a fundamental thing that's necessary for that to happen. You know what that is? Faith. Because if you want miracles, it's going to take faith to do miracles. Huh? You want word of knowledge, it's going to take faith to do word of knowledge. Everything in the manifestation of the power gifts of God has at its hub, as it were, faith. And faith is only going to get the wheel moving and turning, if you would. It's only going to be activated by love. So you're going to have to understand, you're going to have to dwell in these things. You have to dwell in the principles of God, and then go ahead and give yourself to that wonderful thing that now is gifting of the Spirit, manifestation of the Spirit, that is given to us. How? How is it given to us? By a measure of faith. What did the measure of faith do? Produce a grace. What is a grace? A grace is a divine empowerment of God for us to be able to do things. What does the measure of faith do? It gives us a grace to be able to prophesy, a grace to not only be able to prophesy, but I can also say to do works of miracles, to function in gifts of healing, to give words of knowledge, to function in the word of wisdom. This is something that is given to us as a realm of measure of faith. And as we give ourselves to that grace, it grows, it increases, It matures and it multiplies. This is what God promises us. But we have to do it properly. We have to walk right before the Lord. Otherwise, it goes sideways, you get messed up, and people around you get messed up. And it just, once again, it just comes back to this wonderful state of just yielding this to God. What is yielding this to God? Whatever He says, you'll do it. You're just waiting to hear from Him. And maybe He's going to come to you to start off with, and there's going to be a lot of correction. And I'm going to tell you right now, correction is going to continue to go on. And if you're not being corrected on a level to where that you take correction properly, you're a rebellious child. Are you listening to me? That's what God says. I want to just hear, be corrected by God, because He's going to continue to correct me. If I want to move with Him in a greater dimension of His anointing and a greater dimension of the display of His character, His power, then I'm going to have to be willing to do it His way. And I'm going to have to be willing to respond. And I'm ready to respond. Correct me, oh God. Lead me in the way everlasting. That's yieldedness. What do you have to say? Because it's not only on the corrective side. It's also on the directive side. Oh, everybody wants direction. You don't get to have direction and be able to understand direction unless you have correction and you're willing to respond to it. I pray that you become childlike. I pray you, if you're not childlike in terms of being a proper child who responds, you don't need a belt brought out, just a stern voice. You're the man. Look how sensitive David was. You're the man. He had deceived himself. He had justified Bathsheba. He made it all right. He tried to bury it. But look at that sensitive heart. As soon as the word of the Lord came forth by the prophet Nathan, you are the man. Look at him, humble himself before God. That's what made the difference. Is that you? That's got to be you. Because you can have the Holy Spirit with you and in you. You could have been delivered from the bondage of fear and be a son, have the Spirit of the Son whereby you cry, Abba, Father. You can have all of these things where the Spirit of the Lord is there doing all the wonderful things that only He can do. But if you're not willing to respond in obedience to Him, you go nowhere. So tonight, I just want to lead you into a place of getting right with God. I want to lead you, if you're watching me by the web tonight. You know, I'm so blessed, I'm so honored that even Bible schools are using the School of Spirit now in their programs. It's such a blessing to me. And, you know, once again, it's just what God gives. And I'm just honored to be able to be a part of that. But if you're watching by the web, you're watching your classroom tonight, I want you to just respond to get right with God. I want you to, if there's things that have been pointed out that needs to be brought into order into your life, then you need to do it. I don't care what dimension it is. If you're not soft towards the Lord, if God can't speak to you and you immediately become broken and say, is it I? Because I can be comfortable and confident in the love of God, the love that He has for me. And in a moment of correction, I can say, Lord, is it me? And not feel like that He doesn't like me and feel like I'm unwanted, because people come along and they say, well, my dad hollered at me, or, you know, I went through this terrible situation with a dysfunctional relationship. And so as soon as anybody starts becoming authoritarian or becomes, you know, has a voice of correction, everything inside of me just churns. You need to be delivered. That's a demon spirit, and you need to be delivered. That's nothing to do with God. That is not, was that an excuse not to hear God? No. But do you know how many times I've had people tell me that? And do you know how many times when people tell me that those folks want to be delivered? When I say, no, that's a demon spirit. They don't want to be delivered, because the same stronghold that is in their life, that rebellion and that stubbornness refuses not only to be corrected, but refuses to be ever to be wrong. Refuse it. It's stubborn, it's defiant, it's argumentative. Strife is created everywhere they go. The only time strife isn't being created is when they're putting, you know, they've just beat their head up against the wall and they've learned that they just got to keep their mouth shut and vent later. So it's just, you hear me? God is calling you tonight. Listen, He's calling you to a place of repentance. If there's anything that God wants to do in your life, is He wants to call you to a place of being soft. Those of you, there's people that are watching me tonight, You know, you've got offenses against your leadership. You've got offenses against your pastor. Understand that Satan's game. I find it everywhere I go. I know that's his tricks. You don't know that. I know that. Pastors, preachers, evangelists know that. It's what Satan does. He creates any kind of gulf and division he possibly can between you and the one that God has sent to perfect you, to build you up, and to bring you into this place. You need to repent for that right now. You need to understand that the Holy Ghost and the proper response of love is going to create double honor, that you're going to be in a place where you're going to be willing to be hooked up and taught and mentored, hallelujah, and led and guided, hallelujah, because the Holy Ghost is here to do that. Will you respond to God? Will you get right with God? Will you just be subtle, real supple to Him, to where that you're willing to just say, mold me, make me whatever you want me to be. I'll be it, Lord. However you want me to behave, I'll behave it. Behave that way. And you say, well, okay, I just want you to smile, and I want you to walk in love, and I want you to forgive, and I want you to get things right, and I want you to quit acting like you and start acting like me. And he says, don't worry about it. I've empowered you to do it. All you got to do is be willing. Don't try to do it out of your own strength and your ability. I'm with you. I'm in you. I'm here to lead you. I'm here to guide you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you like being in the school of spirit?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
I do.
Every place that I've found, can we just quiet down up here just a little bit? It's all on the tape. Every time it's on the tape. I love you girls, but you're going to have to just get it right. Every time I've found my life, and every witness in every place that I've seen this, where people have risked things, have just sacrificed, have stepped out beyond themselves, and have been willing to do what God has commanded us to do, what Christ Jesus modeled and directed for us to do, they stepped into a greater move of the Spirit of the Lord in their life. And I say to you, how valuable is it to you, these movings of the Spirit? They stepped into a greater gifting and a greater anointing. I say to you, how valuable is the giftings and the anointing? Because at the end of the day, that's what's going to make the difference of whether you're going to risk it, or whether you're going to step out and obey God, whether you're going to go to places like Cuba or Kashmir or across the street or in whatever God gives you to do, whatever the Lord places before you to do. Make your car a taxi cab to heaven. Or let me just say this, come to the meeting just so full of the Holy Spirit, so recognizing that it doesn't matter what happens between the time you leave your house, where you're already full of the Holy Ghost, and the time you get to the church, there's nothing going to be able to quench that glory, that flow, that anointing, so that you can walk into the meeting and be who God has purposed you to be as a member in the body of Christ. Because once again, you're not going to do that unless you're dwelling in love. You're not going to do that because it's going to take faith to do that. You're not going to have a lavish display of praise. It's just going to be, you're going to be in and out. You're going to be walking in and out. You're going to have other interests. Your issues and the things about you are going to be more important to you than your role and responsibility to God. And I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me. Father notices every time a person gets up and walks out of the meeting. You understand me? It's written down. I want you to understand this. It's written down. And I want to tell you this. You better have a very good reason. Because God has made a way for everybody to be forgiven for violations against the anointing. But you have to repent. And people do things that they have justified and that they have made right, where they literally dishonor that which is sacred. And they never repent because they've justified it in their own mind. They can just do whatever they want to do because they're in charge. Their whole life is about them. It's true. They have never really understood how to come under the yoke of obedience to the Holy Ghost and only moving and doing what God says to do and having His interest above their own interest. And that's got to change if you want to be a student of the Holy Ghost. That's got to change if you want to stand right before God. That's got to change. You're going to have to get yourself some holy fear. You're going to have to get yourself some God consciousness. You're going to have to recognize, wait a minute, you're not in charge, and whatever you think you should do isn't reality. This world and this universe was not created around you. God's not letting you call the shots. It's not about what you think at all. You're supposed to be a servant of the living God under the rulership of Almighty God. And those things that belong to Him are supposed to be so sacred to you that you do not want to step out of line, not one single time.
True.
And God has given you His leaders, His Word, His Holy Spirit, and the full declaration of God manifested in the flesh to help you understand that. He's not come up, I'm telling you right now, he's not come up short, right? He's gone way overboard for us. Now, if you're going to be so set on doing it your own way, that you're going to reach beyond that and still say, well, I can just do whatever I want to do. I can just do it anytime I want to do it, whatever I feel, whatever just comes into my mind, whatever comes into my thoughts, whatever I think is good. You'll never be led by God. You can never say that you're led by the Holy Ghost. You can never say that you're guided by Him. You can never say that you're ruled by Him, because it's all or it's not at all. It's true. Let this become a reality to you tonight. Get yielded to Him. Understand the responsibility that you have to represent Him. Recognize that it's all found in this relationship. God wants to, Holy Spirit wants to reveal Jesus. And you're going to have to start worshiping. And she's going to have to get corrected. Listen, Anna, what's wrong with you? Honestly, what's wrong with you? Because this is ridiculous. And you're going to stop it. You hear me? Or are you going to sit on another row? Because you can't behave like this and go pray for people. You can't sit here and fight your dad and expect to have some kind of approval, because you're wrong and you need to repent and you need to get right. Do you understand me? Do you understand me, girl?
Yeah.
Okay, well then do it. There's no question about it in my mind that she understood everything I said. But whether she would do it or not, just depends on what mood she's in, because she's a child that is being disciplined. And much of her behavior is going to actually be dictated on whether or not she gets a belting, whether or not she gets disciplined. And I'm saying all this for you. I'm talking to you, every one of us, me, every one of us. This is the way it is. What changes? What makes you different in your behavior, in your attitude, in your action, when that dynamic is played out or worked out or lived out better between you and the Holy Ghost? Well, thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love. Any good? He loves us when we didn't deserve it, and He loves us when we still didn't deserve it. Hallelujah. And it's wonderful to get into a love relationship where He goes, wow, thank you so much. Thank you so much for representing me. Thank you so much for doing it my way. Thank you for honoring me. Thank you for putting me first. Thank you for being willing to be bent and bowed before me. Thank you for bringing all that you are to my service, to the service of my kingdom and of my purposes. Because you and I are left to decide. And He's not forcing anybody. And that's really scary. Because our will better be honed by His will. And that's only possible by you and I obeying the Word. Your will never be honed to God's will unless you become an absolute obedient person in towards the Word of God. To say, yes, I will do it. I will obey you, Lord. And that absolute obedience means that if you fail, you say, Father, forgive me, and you repent. That's part of obedience. Are you with me? I didn't say absolute perfect person. I said absolute obedient person. To say, I'm going to obey every word of God. If I fail, I'm going to repent. That's obedience. I'm going to repent. I'm going to get it right so that I obey. I'm going to learn. I'm going to be instructed in God's way. There He'll hone your will to His will. There your heart becomes so sensitive to the Holy Spirit. This is how you become, your senses become exercised to move with God, because you obey His, you hear His word, you know His word, and you obey His word. Hallelujah. You can do that a couple hours a day, at least an hour a day.
That'd be good, especially when she doesn't want it. Habosakita la Masaya. Father, I just pray right now in the name of Anna, lift your hands towards heaven. Look at me. Look at me. Anna, the Lord has called you to obey your father and your mother, to be obedient, to be a proper child, a loving child, a submissive child. I know you have a will, and I know you've got all these things that you want to do. But Father has commanded that you do what your father wants you to do and what your mother wants you to do. And that's not a prison. And that's not a bad life. That's a good life. That's liberty. That's blessing. And I say the same thing to you. I say the same thing to you. I say the same thing to you that are watching tonight, either by web or by YouTube. Will you really, truly come into the school of the Spirit? Be willing to have your will honed to His will. Be willing to come to a place of sensitivity and yieldedness to God the Holy Spirit through that obedience to His Word, that the Holy Spirit can lead you and guide you into every dimension of the life and the ways of God. And as Jesus said, listen to this, take all that the Father has and reveal it to you. Wow. 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 I want that more than anything. I want that more than anything. Whatever price there is to pay, I'll pay it. I'll pay it. I'll gladly pay it. And the price is simple obedience to no longer do our will, but to do His will. And understand me tonight, that's not subjective. Once again, it's taught to us by the Word of God. And I'll listen. The beautiful thing is, the Holy Spirit empowers us to do the Word. I want everybody to stand with me. I'm in an altar call here with you tonight. I'm in an altar call with the people that are watching by the web. I'm in an altar call meeting with those that are watching on YouTube. Father's calling. His arms stretched out. He beckons all men to come. Father, so earnest to pour out the gifts of the Spirit. God is so earnest to glorify His only begotten Son in the earth. He's so earnest that the church rise up and be filled with the worship and the praise and the manifest presence and the giftings of the Holy Ghost that brings such a captivating presence to the heart of all men. The issue is, will you do it? Will you even be willing? Is there anybody even in this place tonight that even has such a passion, that has such a heart, that so wants to even be a part of what God has described, that it doesn't matter what it costs you or what you've got to do, it's more important to you than anything else? When that happens, then all the circumstances and all the situations and all the things about you and other interests will no longer be able to affect in any way your emotions. They will never be able to keep you from that place of lavish worship and praise. They'll never hold you back into a place separated, as it were, from an interaction with the living God. Which is the biggest lie that Satan tells on those who've been made one with God. Hallelujah. Tonight, if there's things that need to get right, you need to get right. Get them right right now. Just repent right now. Just tell Father right now. Just talk to the Holy Spirit right now. Just talk to the Lord Jesus right now that you're going to obey His Word and you're sorry for every place that you've been hard and you've been calloused and you've been unwilling. Just repent right now. Just surrender everything right now. Say, Lord, I withhold nothing from you. You just tell Him in your heart. You don't even have to say it out loud. I just need to tell Him. It needs to go so deep in your spirit. Whatever it is that's going on in your life, let it be known between you and God tonight that you're His, and everything that you have and everything that you are belongs to Him. and that you're not doing it your own way anymore. And you're going to come under His leadership. You're going to come under His yoke. And oh, His yoke is easy and His burden is light. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now just get filled up. Now just get tired of Moshiach. Now just get refreshed in the Holy Ghost right now. Just be overwhelmed with His presence right now. Just be captivated with all that He is. Just give yourself to dwelling in His love. Give yourself to worship. Give yourself to worship. Just worship Him. Just love Him. Just praise Him. Just thank Him for His goodness. Hallelujah. Don't walk around like you're working so hard and you're straining so hard and you're left outside. Walk around skipping, worshiping, shouting, giving thanks because you are living and dwelling. Hallelujah. In Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the living God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Don't search around in the Bible to find a character that you want to be like. Look at Jesus and be who He is. Be the lover that He is. Be the one full of joy that He is. Be the one that moves in the gifts of the Spirit like He moves in it. Don't follow anyone else. If you do not have a desire to move in the gifts of the Spirit, in signs and wonders and miracles, I'm going to tell you right now, you're not a follower of Jesus. If you're not willing to walk in the love that lays down your life for a lost and dying world, and especially the brethren, you're not a follower of Jesus. Understand me. If you're not willing to walk in His joy and represent the Father and put the Father first, you're not a follower of Jesus. If you're not willing to come under the yoke of only doing Father's will and doing it just like He says it, just like He describes it, not adding to it or taking away from it, you're not a follower of Jesus. And we're praying in Jesus' name that tonight that will change in every person's life and that you'll be a follower of Jesus. And every place that you weren't following Him, you take hold of Him. And tonight, your passion changes. Your passion changes. And I promise you the Holy Ghost will lead you, He will guide you, He will empower you, and it'll be fun the whole time. Live the life. Have a good time. Live the life. Find a bunch of people. Hug them. Bless them. Tell them that you love them. Consecrate yourself to living out this life because, oh, wow, it's the best thing.